We've been going to the same synagogue for many, many years. And it's worth saying that in this particular synagogue, there are many distinguished members. We've got two ambassadors, many entrepreneurs, educators, rabbis. It's a very distinguished community. And they have a policy of having different members give the sermon. When the different members give their sermon, the one that people are most quiet is when Professor Aumann stands up to give the sermon. Yes.
I haven't noticed.
You can hear the quiet. And I think one of the reasons is that Professor Aumann has a really unique way of thinking about problems. And I remember one particular sermon that you gave, this was many years ago, about Avram and Yitzhak up on the mountain.
Yeah.
And I remember you started off analyzing Avram.
Yeah.
And from then you said, well, one second, everybody, there's somebody else we need to think about from his perspective.
Yeah.
And you said, now we need to talk about Yitzhak's perspective.
Yeah.
And then everyone went quiet and you said, but there's actually one more perspective that we need to analyze here.
Yeah.
And that is God.
Yeah.
And the fact that you look at things in so many different ways, I think is really unique.
Uh-huh.
So when I was starting to write or think about writing my book on artificial intelligence, it was really amazing to come and discuss some of the ideas with Professor Aumann. And I would say, like I expected, it became unexpected. So I started off with a series of questions on artificial intelligence.
Uh-huh.
And very quickly in our conversation, I found us talking about even more basic ideas, which was what makes us humans conscious. And I found that fascinating. So thank you very much for sharing some of your thoughts. And so the first question I wanted to ask is if you could share what made you interested with the idea of consciousness, of human consciousness.
Well, it is the last great enigma of science. The last great enigma of science. I mean, I think, almost the last. There's also what brought about the universe from the scientific point of view. Before the Big Bang, what brought about the Big Bang? Where did it all come from? That's a question which I think scientists are not facing, or at least not discussing. Maybe they're facing it, I don't know. But the other one is consciousness, okay? Consciousness is one of the two last great enigmas of science. It used to be life, but life was sort of the problem of what is life. It was solved in principle in the 50s as with the discovery of the function of DNA. DNA was known before that already in the 19th century, but its function was not known. And in the 50s, in the early 50s, with the discovery of the function of DNA, I think science more or less understands life, but it doesn't understand consciousness. When did I start? I have a paper in the 90s which mentions consciousness, okay? The reason is that I make my living from game theory, yes? Okay, that's my racket. The most basic idea in game theory is that of incentives. Yes, I think incentives. You know what? I could look at that paper and see how consciousness came into it. Okay, see, you was asking about rationality. Okay.
Yeah.
And rationality is not in the sense of figuring things out, but in the sense of promoting your own goals, okay? A person is rational if he tries to promote his own goals. Game theory is based on rationality. Yes? Each player in a game wants to promote his own goals. So now this person was asking about What is the evolutionary function of consciousness? What I'd like to suggest is that consciousness evolved because it serves a very important evolutionary function, namely that it enables people to think rationally in the sense of utility maximization, okay? Promoting your own goals. You're not only a computing machine, you have goals to achieve. For that, you must be conscious. You must be able to experience, you must be able to say, this is pleasurable, this is painful. Just an example of that. What is the function of taste in food? Why must it have a taste? Well, it must have a taste because if it did not taste good, we would not be motivated to eat it, and then we would starve to death. We have to be conscious for that. We can't taste something without being conscious. The consciousness enables us to experience pleasure and pain. It has long been recognized that pain has a very important evolutionary function. I'm suggesting that pleasure also does. Okay, so this is 1998, okay? So since then, I've been interested in consciousness, okay? At least since then. People have been thinking about consciousness and its function for even longer, yes? Okay, from the early 90s or the 80s, yes? Nobody said this, nobody.
Why do you think there's such a lack?
Why did nobody? No,
I will suggest something. Tell me what you
think. Yeah.
When you did a lot of your experiments in game theory,
yeah,
there's obvious business applications that people then can take and implement. I'm not so sure it's so clear with work on consciousness.
I think that people did not think in terms of incentives.
Yeah.
People did not think in terms... neuroscientists do not think in terms of incentives.
So maybe it's worth just asking if you could give a brief explanation for how consciousness works from the incentives.
Well, how consciousness works, I don't know at all, okay? First of all, let me answer the second one of your questions, which is, what is consciousness?
Yes.
What is it, yes? Okay. So even that is difficult to answer. My answer is it's not only the ability to experience, but experiencing. Experiencing, okay? And not sensing. When you walk along the street in a comfortable neighborhood, a well-to-do neighborhood, yes, as you walk along the street, lights go on. Lights go, yeah? There was a sensor in the house that senses you walking on the street, okay, and turns on the light, all right? Because it's a well-to-do neighborhood and they want to see who's walking along, yeah? So that's a sensor. And for that matter, more simple things like an air conditioner, he senses... whether it's cold or warm. Sometimes our air conditioning doesn't do that too well, but it's at least in principle, okay? Whether it's warm or cold and turns on and off the air conditioner accordingly, okay? So sensing is not consciousness, okay? Consciousness is experiencing. You say, what is experience? I say I can't tell you. If you have never experienced anything, then I can't explain to you what experience is. Yes, experience is conscious experience. Okay, it's your identity. You get involved. A congenitally deaf person cannot understand what music is. She can understand, or he can understand, all about the physics of vibrating strings and so on, yes, but they will not understand what music is. Not only they will never know, you cannot explain it to them, right? You can't explain to a deaf person what music is. You have to be able to experience, not only be able, but actually experience things yourself in order to understand what experience is, okay?
So does that mean that there is a barrier that an artificial form of intelligence will never be able to...
I think so. Well, never is a tough word, yes. I won't say never. But I think the current approaches or the current AI, yes, AI as it is currently, yes, is not at all related to consciousness. Not at all related to consciousness. AI does not begin to fulfill the functions of consciousness. Or maybe in the future some other way will be done. This I don't guarantee, yes. My thesis is that consciousness is experiencing, and not only experiencing, but also, maybe that comes in a later question, maybe, but the idea is emotions. And I think machines, artificial emotion does not exist and has not begun to exist. There's no such thing. Artificial intelligence, yes. Artificial emotion, no.
So maybe I'll ask a different question there. Let's call it jumps or leapfrogs of recent years in artificial intelligence comes from games. So the most recent one is when some folks were teaching software to beat the best chess players and then Go players, etc. And some of the scientists took a lot of inspiration from the fact that the software was coming up with artificially new ideas itself.
Yeah, yeah.
That they weren't feeding it with some tree decision-making process, etc.
Okay, all right, yes. But deep learning, deep learning.
Yeah, deep learning. But that's obviously got nothing to do with consciousness, but it was a way for them to see that the beginning of a new layer of intelligence was being formed.
Yeah, that's right. Their own ideas, yeah.
Yeah, so the question is, is there something that could happen, maybe in 10 years, maybe in 100 years, that might be the equivalent of a game that then would make some folks say, you know what? Artificial intelligence might start coming towards artificial consciousness.
Yeah, you know, maybe, yes, but I don't see how, because you have to want something. Yeah, in other words, the function of consciousness is wanting something, okay? On the face of it, a machine can't want, yes? Why would a machine want, yes? What, the machine has to have its own interests, okay? Its own goals, the machine. Not the goals you put into it, but its own goals, yes? Well, you know, I wouldn't rule it out entirely, yes? I mean, you could say, okay, we'll give it the goals and then it'll... But I don't, you know, I won't rule it out. Yes, I won't rule it out. 100 years, okay? But we're not there yet. Now we're not there.
And then maybe just to go back to what you were saying, so there's obviously, and you mentioned this in the most recent paper quite elaborately, a correlation or you connect between the emotions that people feel to their incentives or how they build
them. Of course, yes. Incentives are fed by emotions, yes. Okay, for example, in order to survive, we have to eat. Why do we have to eat? We have to eat to get energy. We have to eat to grow. We have to eat because there are vital minerals and vitamins and so on that enable us to function, and we use them up, and they are in the food. Okay, so we have to eat. But that's not the reason that makes us eat. We eat because we're hungry, okay? And hunger is painful, all right? And we don't want to feel that pain. We don't want, okay, there's that word, want, okay? We don't want to feel discomfort. I mean, hunger is not painful, it's uncomfortable, okay? It's discomfort. Now, comfort is an emotion, and It's something we want to avoid discomfort.
So maybe just one final question.
Yeah.
I'm just curious if you think that given that you are religious,
yeah,
that has an effect on how you analyze or research this type of topic compared to some of the other folks who have looked into human consciousness.
No. No. This is a purely scientific endeavor. I don't think I was motivated by religion in any way in this research, okay? No. I don't really see that religion bears on it.
It's worth taking this opportunity just to thank you again. It's always so enlightful to hear what you have to say, and hopefully for many, many years to come, we can carry on learning from many of your thoughts and ideas.
Okay, very good.